I'm finally living with a heart that is free. Out of the dark, right where you want me to be. And now I know that this is the good.
We're kicking off this new series today called The Good Life, and I titled this series The Good Life intentionally. It's a series that we're going to be in over the next 4 weeks on generosity, and quite honestly, for the first 2 years of our church, I shied away from talking about money. And last summer, I was having lunch with a guy who goes to Hope City, and we have a pretty good relationship, and he asked me, he said, hey, can I just ask you something? He said, I've been coming to Hope City for about 18 months, and I've never heard us talk about finances. He's like, you talk about finances and give a financial update. He's like, but you never really teach on it. Is there a specific reason for that? And I said, well, I don't like it. I don't like talking about it. I don't like teaching about it. I just don't like doing it. And he's like, well, would you say that you should teach as a pastor of the church and as you lead people, you should teach them how to have a biblical marriage? Yeah, would you teach them how to, you know, what the Bible says about parenting? Yeah, would you teach them what the Bible says about relationships, what the Bible says about integrity, what the Bible says about, you know, loving others? Yes, 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 yes. He's like, well, why don't you feel compelled to teach people what the Bible says about money? And I was like, all right, check, please. And he's paying. I'm out. No, but it was just this convicting thing that just because I don't like something doesn't mean I'm not called to do it. Right? And so last fall, we did our very first generosity series, and we masked it really well. It was called Generous. It was like really camouflage there. And we got really not just good reviews about it, but I had people who had never really been taught the biblical perspective of giving say, man, that was really helpful for me. And so I come to you today, saying, hey, we're going to take the next 4 weeks to talk about generosity, and I don't do it apologetically from that standpoint, but I want you to know I'm growing as a leader, and I'm growing as a pastor in that I want to dive into this, and I want to embrace this, and I want to give you guys principles that have shaped my life as a follower of Jesus and have shaped my life as a pastor and how I've seen God show up in some unbelievable ways. And so we're going to look at what the Bible has to say about money. And our mission is to help people find hope, and that's really evangelism. We want to create a space. We say all the time, we want to create a space people love so they can experience God's love. But the second part of our mission is to help people follow Jesus. And following Jesus includes all aspects of our life. And so this is going to be a level of discipleship. This is going to be a level of us growing and saying, okay, God, what do you want from me in this area? And here's what I know about all of us here, in a room this size and a church our size, we have people, I pray that we have people here that don't believe in Jesus. Pray that we have people here that maybe believe in God, they have never really entered a relationship with Jesus. And I think this series is for you. And we have people here that have been in church literally since the day they were born. I think this series is for you as well and everybody in between. And so I hope that we jump in to what this is going to be about over the next 4 weeks and really pursue the good life. When I was growing up, we didn't have a lot of money. We were pretty poor. We lived in a trailer next to my grandmother until I was about 3 years old. Then we moved into a trailer park, and then we moved into a little town called Ladoga, Indiana, into a trailer next to another trailer. And I lived in a trailer until I was about 6 or 7 years old. And then we finally moved into a house. After my dad got a different job, we could afford to live in a house, but we rented. And we rented like for the next, until I was out of high school. Actually, my parents bought their first house when I was in college, and so we moved 17 times from the time I was born until the time I graduated from high school, all in the same town for the most part, but my parents either couldn't afford rent, or they couldn't pay rent, or so that we got kicked out, or we got moved to a different house, or we found a different house, or a cheaper house, and we just moved constantly, And there was sometime around junior high or high school that I began to build in my mind a picture of the life that I wanted that did not include the poverty that I had lived in. And by poverty, I mean we were on food stamps, and we never went homeless or hungry. My parents would borrow money from my grandparents, and we had family members that would help us out at times. And so I was never without shelter. I was never without food, but we were constantly without money. And I began to build this picture of the life that I wanted that was way different than the life that I grew up in. And in my mind, the good life had a certain house. It looked, you know, that looked like it was a part of the good life, and it had certain cars, and it had a certain neighborhood, and it had the good life included a certain tax bracket, and the good life included shopping at certain stores, and hanging out with certain people, and being a part of certain clubs. And there was this pursuit. I began to set goals in high school, and I began to be driven in college to not live the bad life that I lived as a child, but to provide for my family a life that was way better. And then God called me into ministry. No, I'm just joking. little side note, this is not in my notes, but I did my very first youth ministry full time. I made $14,000. So just above the poverty line. And we had Micah, and it was me, Trish, and Micah on 14 grand. And so anyway, that was really not the good life that I had planned for. But over the last 15 years, what God has taught me is the good life and the life that he longs for us has far less to do with the stuff that we have and more to do with the impact that we make. And so over the next 4 weeks, we're going to talk about how we can live the good life that God has created us to live, life and life to its fullest, a life of significance and impact and legacy and generosity. There's a verse, a passage of scripture in 2 Corinthians that are going to kind of guide us over the next 4 weeks. We'll come back to this verse each of the next 4 weeks in a different way, but we're going to look at the whole thing together this morning. It says this is Paul talking, and in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, there's a church that has committed a certain amount of money to Paul. And I don't know if Paul's nervous that they're not going to give it. I don't know if he's heard rumors that maybe they don't have the money, but they have promised him a certain amount of money for his ministry. And so he, in the first 4 or 5 verses of this chapter, he talks about sending somebody to the church ahead of him to make sure they have the funds ready for when he arrives. Okay, and so there's a context here of a church promising generosity to fuel and fund Paul's ministry. And so this is what he's writing. So this is his specific audience, but it has application to us today. It says, remember this, a farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. Now this is just straight up economics, okay? Like there's no rocket science to this. He's saying large amount of seed, large amount of crop. Small amount of seed, small amount of crop. I spent 4 years as a headhunter placing commercial bankers in banks. And when I first started, I had to go to this thing called rookie school. And you basically are, it's all over the phone sales. And they have this module of rookie school called dialing for dollars. I'm not joking you, okay? And so my goal was to make 100 phone calls per day, because their theory is until you learn the art of recruiting, you have to tap into the science of recruiting. And the science of recruiting, it says if you call more people, you can make more money. And so when Paul's talking here, he's not giving some, you know, absurd biblical principle. He's just giving an agricultural principle that is actually true. If you plant a small amount of seed, you're going to get a smaller amount of crop. If you plant a large amount of seed, you're going to get, you have the potential to have a larger crop. You must each decide in your heart how much to give, and don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. And God will generously provide all that you need. Then you'll always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. As the scriptures say, they share freely and give generously to the poor. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. This generous God who supplies abundant seed for the farmer, which becomes bread for our meals, is even more extravagant toward you. First, he supplies everything, every need, plus more. Then he multiplies the seed as you sow it, so that the harvest of your generosity will grow. You'll be abundantly enriched in every way as you give generously on every occasion. For when we take your gifts to those in need, it causes many to give thanks to God. So last fall when we did this giving series, we talked about there are stages of generosity. That each of us progress, hopefully as we grow in our relationship with God, we grow in a life of generosity. And so last year we talked about the first stage of a generous person is what we call a rookie giver. It's also be called a random giver, okay? This is a person who decides to give for the very first time. And there is a question that is asked every single time we're prompted to be generous. And the first question, the question of a rookie giver is, do I like this place enough to give? Like, is this a place that I can believe in? Is this a place that I can put my trust in? Do I like the people? Do I like being there? Does it make me feel good about myself? And as you encounter churches, it takes 12 to 18 months for a person who goes to a church to decide to give. Now, thankfully, many of us at Hope City are ahead of that curve. Otherwise, we would not exist. Because how old are we as a church? We're 38 months old. Okay, and so relatively speaking, all of us here are newer givers when it comes to our giving at this church. But as we were ramping up this church, it was important for us to have outside resources coming in, knowing that there are going to be people who are sitting there evaluating whether or not they like this place enough to give. And this is, I don't want to make light of the rookie giver. Because if you have never given generously, if you've never given back to God, this is a huge step. When you decide to write a check, when you decide to give online for the very first time, this is a milestone in your spiritual development. It's like you saying, okay, God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to be generous. I'm going to give back to you. I like this place enough to invest in it. Now, as our generosity progresses, there's another level of giving that we grow into, and this is what we call reoccurring giving. This is where random gifts become consistent gifts. This is when somebody says, they ask this question, how much can I afford to give? As you grow, not just in your relationship with God, but as you grow in your relationship with the church that you're attending, whether it be Hope City or another church, you get to this question, okay, I like this mission of this place. I want to be a part of the mission of this place. Now, how much can I afford to budget, to allocate, to direct toward the mission and vision of this church? Right? And so people who come to this stage, they sit down and they say, okay, I don't want to just give randomly. I want to give consistently. I want it to be a discipline. I want it to be a habit. And so they work out a budget and they say, okay, based on my budget, here's the amount that I can afford to give. And they begin to set that up in a reoccurring way. Last time Paul did the financial update, he talked about reoccurring giving. That's a priority for us as a church, not because we want to lock you into, you know, a contract that you can never get out of, but because it helps us project what our expenses and what our budget can be based on the consistency of the people who call this place home. And so last year at this time, we had 38 families that were reoccurring givers. And I challenged you last fall, I said, okay, could you begin, if you're a rookie giver, could you begin to move in this direction? Do you want to know how many people are reoccurring givers, how many families we have that are reoccurring givers? Half of our budget every month, almost to the dollar, is set up on reoccurring giving. Not half of our budget. Half of our giving every single month is set up on reoccurring giving. We have 72 families right now that are set up on reoccurring giving. So many, this isn't like, look what you guys are doing wrong. No, this is like, hey, this is awesome. Look how much we have grown, right? And so we want to grow in generosity, and many of you have taken that step. You say, okay, I believe in this place. And this is not necessarily a percentage, okay? Sometimes this is $10 a week. Sometimes this is $5 a week. Sometimes this is $100 a month. Sometimes this is, you know, a one-time gift or a monthly gift of $500. It looks different for everybody. This isn't based on a percentage. This is based on your income, okay? Now, as we grow in our generosity, we move from reoccurring giving, we move into this place called relational giving. And relational giving is not based on your relationship with Hope City or Grace or Genesis or Northview or whatever church you're part of. Relational giving is based on your relationship with God. It's where you move from, okay, I'm just going to look at how much I can afford. I'm going to start asking a different question. I'm going to start asking the question based on my relationship with God is, what would God want me to give? Like, what's God's plan for my life? What's God's will for my life? What does God ask of me? And it's based on your love, your admiration, your relationship that you have developed with God. It's based on God's grace in your life, his provision in your life, and your recognition that out of an overflow of everything that God has given you, you want to be generous. You want to give back. And it's based on what God has asked. And the people that move into this place, they say, you know what? I'm going to take the first 10% of everything that God gives me, and I'm going to give it to God. Some are like, well, that's an Old Testament. We'll get into that later in the sermon. Okay, let's not argue about that. But that's mostly what people who are in this relational aspect of giving, that's where they start. The Bible talks about a tithe. It talks about giving 10% of our income back to him. And people that move from the reoccurring into the relational say, okay, God, if you ask me for 10%, I've seen you show up, I've seen you be faithful, and I'm going to give back what you ask. Now, the last group of people, as we grow in our generosity, are what we call radical givers. These people are just crazy. They're nuts, all right? But they fund and fuel a lot of the mission of God, not just at Hope City, but I'm talking about the capital C church and the kingdom of God worldwide. The kingdom of God worldwide could not exist without people in this category, because the people in this category, they are giving in a reoccurring way relationally. They're giving 10%, and then they get to this place where they feel inspired, or they feel prompted, or they feel like God is speaking to them, or they feel moved by a mission, or they feel moved by a project, and they say, you know what? God has given me way more than I could ever ask or imagine. I want to give over and above. I want to give in a radical way to fund and fuel the mission of God. And we had to have radical givers to be able to move in this facility. We had to have radical givers last Christmas when we did our Give Hope Christmas offering. We said, okay, we're gonna partner with Urban Act Academy, and we're going to buy a pair of shoes for all 340 kids that go there. And we thought it was going to be $7,000 and ended up being $10,500, but who's counting, right? Because every kid got a pair of shoes. And you know what we had to have? Our goal was $70,000 of a year-end offering, and we're going to say, we're going to take 10% of that, and we're going to give it to Urban Act. And people stepped up in a radical way, and we were able to give them over $10,000 worth of shoes, and we were able to provide a Christmas memory for them that they're still talking about. I went down and met with Urban Act. We're going to talk about Urban Act over the next couple of weeks. I went down and met with the headmaster down there last week, and there are kids still wearing those shoes. And that would not have happened without radical giving. Now, that's just a review, and that's just kind of the terms that we put in place last fall. Okay? Now, as you begin to engage in thinking through your generosity and what generosity looks like in your personal life, you're going to have to process and deal with two competing economies. And the first economy is the earthly economy that we live in our culture. And there are certain beliefs that guide our economy. There are certain beliefs that guide the earthly way of thinking that we have when it comes to money, resources, and possessions. And the first way that we think of when, generosity, you know, go back, okay. I don't want to skip that. What we're talking about over the next 4 weeks is generosity is more about our heart than it is about our money. Now, some of you are like, I don't think that's true. Well, it doesn't feel true sometimes. Sometimes it just feels like generosity is about money. And that's because of the way that we've been brought up. It's because of the predisposition that we have about money. It's because of the church experience that we have. All those things factor into how we perceive generosity. But as we engage in this idea of generosity, we're going to have to discern, and we're going to have to filter out two competing economies. Now we can go to our economy, our earthly economy. The first premise, the first belief is, I own it all. When you just talk about our culture, the American culture, the belief is whatever you have, you own. Whatever you own, it's yours. Like nobody else owns it. You have earned it. You've worked for it, and you own it all. The second belief is, I create my own success. If you grind hard enough, if you work hard enough, this is the American dream. If you're talented enough, you're gifted enough, you can create your own success. Just look at Facebook. Just look at all the opportunities you have for entrepreneurship, right? Like there's businesses all over the place, right? And if you work hard enough and you can grind hard enough and you can hustle enough, then you can create your own success. And you're ultimately responsible for your success or failure. The third premise is the more I have, the more successful I will be. Or the more I have, the more happy I will be. Or the more I have, the more influential I'll be. Or the more I have, the more valuable I will be. Or the more I have, the more significant I will be. And when our economy gets into our heart and gets into our head, we begin to be driven to acquire and achieve and to purchase, not necessarily because we're greedy, but because we're hungry for significance. We're hungry for value. We want to prove to everybody that we mean something. And this economy, the economy that we live in every single day, gives you the belief that the more you have, the more you acquire, the more you build, the more valuable you're going to be. The next premise is what I acquire is a reflection of my ability. You want to know if somebody's talented, gifted, special, smart? Look at how much they have acquired. Look at how much they have achieved. Look at how much they have purchased. Look at the house they live in. Look at the car they drive. Because what I acquire is a reflection of my abilities. It's a reflection of my skills. It's a reflection of my talents. Now, there's a different economy that flies in the face of this. This economy promises you the good life. This economy promises you the good life, but it leaves us wanting more. It's why we can never have enough. It's why we can never buy enough. It's why we're always looking for the next house, always looking for the next car. Not that any of those things are bad, but what they're driven by is this hole in our heart that we feel like the next purchase will fill. Then there's this other economy. It's God's economy. It's what I call the good life economy. And it starts with this premise, that God owns it all. Like this is this shift from I own it all to God owns it all. Tuesday nights are a buy one, get one free at B-dubs. All right, that's free. All right? It would not include in the offering. I'm just saving you money right now. Buy one, get one free at B-dubs. And so if you buy a snack, you get another snack for free. If you buy a small, you get another small free. You see where this is going? Buy a medium, get another medium for free. All right? So we go to B-dubs frequently on Tuesdays. And so we're at B-dubs this last Buffalo Wild Wings. For those of you that have never been there, we go to Buffalo Wild Wings on Tuesday this last week. And Trisha and Jalen are having a conversation about the menu. And Jalen is going to be 10 years old in December, and he is looking to graduate from the children's menu, and I want to have money, and so I'm looking for him to stay on the children's menu. And so they're having a discussion about what he's going to order, and it's buy one, get one free. And so she says, hey, Jalen doesn't want to get a kid's menu, get a kid's meal. He wants to not even get a snack. He wants to get a small. And I said, well, a small is actually two smalls, which is actually a medium. He's like, Dad, I'm going to eat it all. All right, dial it up. All right, let's order it. So they bring out this mound of wings. And I'm looking at his wings, and they look really good. He has honey barbecue, and I don't. And so I'm craving, now that I'm seeing his wings, I'm craving the honey barbecue. And so he's eating, and he's diving in the wings. I'm really proud of him. But I'm, like, craving the wings. And so I reach over, and I grab a wing. Pop it in my mouth, boneless. Pop it in my mouth, and, oh, man, it was good. And he just gives me a look like he's going to kill me. And I'm like, what? He's like, I'm okay. And so a few minutes later, I'm looking at his wings. They're just calling my name. So I reach over, I grab another one. He's like, Dad, stay out of my food. These are my wings. Ooh, parents, you know what I'm talking about right now. I said, let's call a timeout, my man. Is the check being brought to you? Are you paying for this meal? Right? Get out my soapbox, put the pulpit in the center of the table. I said, I own all these wings. I own every single wing on this table. I own the fried pickles. I own the lukewarm fries. Have you ever gotten fries hot from B-dubs? Never. I own those lukewarm fries. I own all the drinks. I own the water before it even comes out of the faucet at this place. And here's the deal. If you saw my bank account, you would know I could buy all kinds of wings, all right? You would know that I could buy, especially buy one, get one free, more wings that could be contained on these tables. I could buy enough wings that you would not have life enough to eat them. I own everything. And here's the deal, buddy. I'm taking two. I'm leaving you 18. Welcome to tithing, all right? You got 20. I get two. Now, those of you that are parents, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Right? Like, are you serious? Those are your wings? Uh-uh. They're mine. But don't we do the same thing with God? Look what this verse says. Look what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 4:7. He says, what do you have that God hasn't given you? And if everything you have is from God, why boast as if it were not a gift? Like, I am so quick to go, I own those wings. I'm letting you eat 18 of them. Be happy. And then I say, okay, God, I really don't want to give you back 10% of what I get, even though it is from you. Right? It's not a principle that we would teach our kids. It's just a principle we don't apply in our relationship with our Heavenly Father. So that's our first principle, is when you start living the good life, the basic truth that guides your life is this truth. God owns everything. And he just asked me to give back a small portion of it. Next is I manage what God entrusts to me. I manage what God entrusts to me. Look at this passage, and this is a story that Jesus is telling. It's interesting. In the 3-year history of Hope City, I've done one giving series. One out of every three parables Jesus taught was on money. One out of every three parables. Why did the Son of God think it was important to talk about money and giving and generosity once out of every three times that he spoke? Because he knew that our hearts were directly connected to our bank accounts. Right? He knew that. It's not that money's bad. It's money has the potential to invade our relationship with God. So this is Jesus talking. This is a parable. He says, again, it'll be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. One, he gave five bags of gold. To another, he gave two bags. And one another, he gave one bag, and each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. When the man who had received five bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained five more. So also the one with the two bags of gold gained two more. But the man who had received one bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. So there's this principle. The truth is that God entrusts us with different amounts. It feels arbitrary. It feels unfair. I don't know why God entrusts people with different amount of money. He entrusts people with different amount of gifts. He entrusts people with different amount of experiences. He entrusts people with different amounts of influence. And here's the deal. We aren't in control of how much we have been given. What we are in control of is how we manage what God has given us. And when you start living the good life, you realize that God has entrusted you with time and gifts and resources. And then you begin to think about how you can do your best to manage not what is yours, but what is God's. What does that look like in your life? How can you orient your life around managing the gifts and the talents and the time and the money that God has given you? The next principle of the good life is the more I give, the more impactful my life will be. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, he says, you'll be abundantly enriched in every way as you give generously on every occasion. For when we take your gifts to those in need, it causes many to give thanks to God. You can live life, you can live a long life and have very little impact. You can be successful and not be impactful. You can be important at work and really have no kingdom impact at all. Like you can have an entourage of people that travel with you, and you can have all the status and all the corner offices and really leave no lasting eternal impact on this world. It's completely possible, and people do it every day. And this verse says, as you give, three very important things happen. The first thing is your life is enriched. Your life is made better. Your life is improved as you give. The second is others have their needs met. It makes an impact. And the third is people don't look to you. They thank God. When I was down at Urban Act Academy, I was just walking through the halls, and we're kind of legendary down there, with the shoe people, and which is as a person who loves shoes, I love that reputation. But I had two or three different teachers come up to me and say, "Thank you for what you did last year. Hey, where's your church at? Hey, is it okay if I came to your church one Sunday?" Like they saw past the shoes and they saw into the good God that gave them the shoes. It was, we were conduits, right? We were conduits to an impactful situation. We weren't the creators of it. We were just funneling resources from our bank accounts into this kingdom fund that allowed us to have a lasting impact in a group of people's life. And that's what God does. God meets people's need, and they don't necessarily just thank us. They see God at work. The next principle is what I give is an investment into my legacy. What I give is an investment into my legacy. Look at this passage and look at this verse, chapter 9, verse 9. It says, as the scriptures say, they share freely and they give generously to the poor. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. You don't want to know what generous people are remembered for? How generous they were, how much they gave, all the good deeds that they did. My junior year of college, I got an internship in a small town in central Illinois called Vermont, Illinois, population 800. And I was doing a youth ministry internship there for my next year of school, and I didn't have a place to live, and so I lived with this lady, which sounds scandalous, right? She was 68, and she had just lost her husband a few months before that. He had passed away from cancer. And the church was asking for volunteers to house this intern for the summer, and she stepped up and said, "Hey, I have a big house, and now I don't have anybody living there." And So it felt kind of awkward to move in with a grandma, you know, and she was a firecracker. Her name was Millie Beans. I'm not making that up. That was her name. And she welcomed me in, and we became like two peas in a pod. Like, she started watching SportsCenter with me. It was awesome. And we would stay up eating Golden Grahams at night, and I would mow the yard. She would do my laundry. Like, we had this whole system worked out, and we hung out a lot. She traveled a lot. Her husband left her a lot of money, so she went and traveled a lot, and I just had a phenomenal summer with her, and she really just was so generous to me opening her home like that, and I think I provided some cathartic relief for her of her being without her husband for the first time in like 40 years. And so it was just an amazing relationship that we developed. And the last week that I was there, I was preparing to go back to school, and I got a call from the registrar's office at the school. And something happened with either a scholarship or a grant. I can't really remember what happened, but I was going to be $1,100 short of going back to school for the year. And so I think it only had home telephones there then, and so I was sitting at her house on the telephone, and she overheard my conversation, and so I hung up, and she came in the living room. She's like, "Is everything okay?" And I told her whatever happened with my FAFSA, whatever happened with my scholarship, something happened, and I was going to be short on going back to school. She's like, "Well, what's your plan?" I'm like, "Well, I don't really have one. I don't know what to do." And Trisha was taking a semester off to save for our wedding, so I said, "Well, maybe I'll do that." She's like, "You can't do that. You need to graduate from college." And I said, "Well, I'll figure it out." And so that night, she came up into my room, and she sat down on the edge of my bed, and she said, "Hey," she said, I don't have my husband anymore, but I am pretty well off financially now, and I want to loan you the $1,100 to go back to school." And I said, "Wow, Millie, that is amazing. That's unbelievable. I can't believe you'd do that." She's like, "Well, here's the deal. You have to graduate, and you have to go into ministry, and if you do that, you don't have to pay me back." And I often think about that, like, what would my life look like had she not been generous? She had already been generous, right? She would open up her home. She was feeding me literally boxes a week of Golden Grahams. Like, that's generosity at its finest. And here she stepped up with a 19 or 20-year-old kid and said, "I believe in the calling that God has in your life. Every message that I preach, every marriage conference that I do, every word of the book that I wrote, every person that I've counseled, all has the investment, all has the legacy of that $1,100 investment that I believe has been doubled down and doubled down and doubled down, hopefully, in the lives of other people. What legacy is your money going to leave about you with you?" The last principle here as we close is, I give joyfully out of an overflow for all that God has given to me. I give joyfully out of an overflow. Look at this verse 7 of chapter 9. Paul says this: "You each must decide in your own heart." There's biblical principles laid out of generosity. God says over and over again in the Old Testament, bring the whole tithe. Like, he asks for 10%. Jesus then, in the New Testament, kind of doubles down on that and says, hey, you shouldn't compromise good deeds and stop giving the tithe. You shouldn't give the tithe and not do 10%. So there's this biblical foundation already laid, but then Paul says this. He says, "You must each decide in your own heart how much you should give. And don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure." This is not about guilt. The gospel is never about coercion. The gospel is never about guilt or shame or you not being enough for God. That's what Paul's saying. Hey, this isn't about pressure. What this is about, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. The Greek word for this is hilarious. Hilarious. God loves a person who gives hilariously. Like, that laughs as they give because they find so much joy in their giving. And so here's the question as we go through this series. As you decide in your heart, where are you going to line up? Are you going to be a rookie giver? Are you going to be a reoccurring giver? Are you going to be a relational giver? Are you going to be a radical giver? And here's my hope as we go through the next 4 weeks, that you'll just take one step. You'll take one or two steps. Wherever you are in this thing, you'll say, okay, God, I want to live the good life. I want to live a life that far surpasses my time on this earth. And I don't want to just give to you. I want to invest in your kingdom. I want to see your kingdom come to pass. You see, the good life is not about how much we can acquire. It's about how much we can impact, how much of an impact we can make with what we have been given. That's what the good life is all about. And so we're going to get really practical today. As you came in, you saw all the laundry baskets out there. You're like, man, Justin has a lot of laundry. No, that's not for me. That's for you. It's actually not for it's not for you. It's for families at Urban Act Academy. We're going to provide them with Thanksgiving dinner. Last year, we had a goal of providing 25 families with Thanksgiving dinner. So there's a list, a shopping list, in each of those laundry baskets. And as a church, we provided 56 meals, not 25. And you know what happened? God did what God does. He multiplied it. The board of Urban Act Academy doubled. They matched basket for basket what we provided. That's how generosity works. And so this year, our goal is 75. And you know what they're going to do? They're going to match it. So 150 families are going to be able to have Thanksgiving dinner, because we're going to take those baskets, hopefully over the next couple of weeks. We're going to bring them back on the 17th or the 24th, and we're going to take them down to Urban Act Academy and allow them to experience Thanksgiving. And you know what? We're not going to get any credit. It's not going to be in the paper. It's going to be an act of generosity that we get to give. And you know what people are going to say? Man, God is so good. God is so amazing that he would think of me on Thanksgiving Day. 33% of the kids at Urban Act Academy are in homeless shelters. 33% of the kids at Urban Act Academy are in foster care. And the other 33% are just in poverty. And you and I get to, in a tangible way, give them the good life. Christians, people who follow Jesus, being generous. $40 is probably going to be what it takes to fill up one of those baskets. And I think we can knock out 75. Let's pray together. God, we thank you so much that you have given us the path to not just a good life, but life and life to its fullest. And so would you help us just do an inventory of our heart? Like, what economy is driving us? Is it this earthly economy that says, hey, you own it all, you create your own success, what you acquire is a reflection of your gifts? Or is it this other economy, this good life economy that says, hey, God owns it all, and I've been entrusted, I've been invited by the God of the universe to participate in what he's doing on this earth. What an incredible thing. And so God, would you just work in our hearts over the next few weeks and allow us to grow, not just through the money that we give, but through the heart that we have for you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Over the years, God has really changed my perspective on money. When I started out of college, money was very focused on things I could buy for myself and searching for happiness and being more fulfilled by getting more things. It was about buying a newer car. It was about getting a bigger house. It was getting more gadgets. And I really thought that buying the next item would bring me more happiness. And what I found time and time again is that it didn't do that. Those things wore off very, very quickly. And as God drew me back to him, and I started to get involved with church, when I first started, my giving really met with the way I was approaching money. And I looked at giving at church as kind of like paying for a movie ticket. I figured, hey, the church has some expenses. This is kind of like going to a movie. So I'll throw, you know, $10 in the plate and that should cover it. And that's how I approach giving. When I look back on those times, even all my total giving for the year was less than 1% of my income at the time. And God really taught me through a series of people he put in my life to explain to me, you know, how money can be used for his good, to really change my perspective on it. And as I went on, we began to give more out of faith and to really get involved with the missions, both volunteering at the church and then giving more money to the church, with the goal of increasing our giving to a full tithe. There's been incredible joy that comes from being a part of God's mission. And part of that is giving. That is something that has truly brought lasting joy and fulfillment for me. And that's changed everything about my perspective on money and my perspective on giving. Since I've been here at Hope City, you know, one of the things that it's great to be a part of, they talk about the wonderful things that are happening with you know, lives being restored, families being put back together, that giving to Hope City really does fund those things. Taking care of our kids so that the parents can go to worship is a big thing. We had young kids once, and that was a big obstacle for us at the time. Last year, I remember with the giving drive at the end of the year, it hit me really hard, the concept that giving a pair of shoes to every kid at the school in downtown Indianapolis, and wanted to be a part of that. And there's such fulfillment, again, that comes from that. So, you know, my giving journey has really evolved from God just showing me what it's like and what can change in my life as a result of being part of His mission by giving my resources. And it's just been an incredible journey, and I'm so thankful to Him for that, that this is not about a sacrifice. This isn't about giving up on things so that you can give some more money or be guilted into it. This is about changing, you know, change my life, change my outlook and my perspective, and it's brought incredible joy and fulfillment to me throughout the years.